So my topic is interoceptive awareness. So between me and my spell check, we never get this right. I've been telling my wife about this concept for years, and she still doesn't get it either. So another way to talk about this is interoception, which is a slightly more technical word, which I didn't think I would try and attempt, but maybe I should have gone with that. So really, this is about inner body awareness. And this talk is driven by my sort of curiosity and passion around learning. I'm not an expert in this field. I've discovered this probably in the last couple of years, and since then it's just not left me. And I've been following sort of a train of thought, being more and more curious about more and more specific aspects of learning and of shift in people. And I'll tell you how that came about. So there's many ways to slice this cake, you know, in terms of interoceptive awareness. We can look at it academically, and there is lots of evidence. I'm not going to be able to give you all that evidence today. And we can also look at it experientially, but I cannot give you that experience in 15 minutes. But what I would like to do with this talk is just give you a sense of what this thing is and why I'm so obsessed about it, and why I think it's important, and why I think it's going to be important for the talking therapies. So I guess my talk is a bit of an invitation. And I would really like you to engage with me after this for whatever reason. Critique, if you're curious, or for if you need the references, or if you want to have some of the experiences of how we can develop interoceptive awareness. So this all started for me with a hunch. So I've been working with people one-on-one for about 13 years now. I've done about 2,500 hours of coaching. And I was trained in the integral model. So these four quadrants, for those of you who don't know, and I'm sure most of you know what the integral quadrants are, basically divide reality up into four perspectives. And on the left, you have... Yeah. I don't need it, do I?
No.
Okay, so on the left, these are what we call an external perspective or a collective perspective, and these are internal and more individual. And these are subjective and intersubjective, and these are objective and interobjective. And what I discovered after just in the last couple of years of working with people, mostly in organizations, is that people who do well in organizations tend to have these perspectives, and they tend to hang out here. And people who change and are able to hold a self-awareness generally hold these perspectives. Now, Ken Wilber, the philosopher who came up with this, when he talks about reality, I think he's going to say that it's actually about all four quadrants. Reality is about all four quadrants. What I'm talking about is change, and I started wondering whether change wasn't really, firstly, about these quadrants. So similarly, along the lines of build a good self-awareness, and things will follow. But that awareness, for me, is interoceptive. So it's very, very sensory and not conceptual. And that's what I was intrigued with. So one thing you can ask yourself at this point, you see this in sports coaching a lot. They talk about an attention tendency or an attention style. It would be very important for you to ask yourself throughout this presentation, and maybe when you work with clients, what is their attention style and what is my attention style? So in a couple of models of coaching, they would combine this model with a few other models, but this would generally be your first model, and you'd start noticing where your client's hanging out. And you, if they're hanging out in these two, you try and encourage them to develop competencies and capacities in those two. But that also starts with your own tendency. So I started noticing that people who hang out here, and probably more here, start to change. Now I guess if you look at the sort of theorists in this area, Buddha and Freud and those kind of individualist approaches, they were really saying that already. But I started getting curiouser and curiouser about this quadrant, and I started going into it. And when I looked at who was, you know, at the knowledge that we've got there, I started seeing a convergence over time about, you know, various knowledge bases coming together and saying a similar thing, more and more so, especially now with neuroscience contributing so much to the body of knowledge. So the way I saw this convergence was a bit like this. We've had this traditional medical health knowledge, you know, of what, probably 1,000 years now, I guess. We've had Buddhism and contemplative traditions for probably double that. Most of coaches and psychologists and counselors tend to hang around here. And then this, I guess, is more contemporary. But a lot of this is confirming a lot of what this has been telling us. And these two are starting to kind of speak the same language, which I find quite interesting. And I think these guys are learning a lot from these two. And I was quite fascinated by what I call the sweet spot. And that's how I arrived at interoceptive awareness. So I thought I was onto something new, but turns out there's a lot out there already. But I'm still learning it, and I'm still curious, and I'm still quite psyched that it's really powerful. So the first thing that I think is important, and this is where neuroscience comes in, and a lot of you will know this already. The first element of the interior, that I quadrant, and of interoceptive awareness that is key, is attention. So Buddhists have been saying this for a very long time. Mindfulness teaches us this. This is the stuff you know about neuroplasticity and how our thoughts can change the actual structure of your brain. So if you have a thought and it's first chemical and electrical, and that chemical and electrical impulse is consistent, that starts to become structural. So the New Age movement says thoughts become things. But literally that's what you're doing. You're flowing by paying attention to something consistently. You're having those electrical and chemical impulses, and you're literally changing the structure of your brain. And there are some radical examples of that. So William James, 100 years ago, who's, I reckon, a pretty underrated psychologist, wasn't as famous as Freud and Jung, and probably now starting to come up again because neuroscientists are starting to confirm his approach, especially his approach to emotion. So he said attention would be an education par excellence, agreeing again, I think, with the Buddhists. So this is my first concept, attention. It's one of the first sort of elements, one of two, of interoceptive awareness, and that I think is very important. The second one, which I guess is more specific to actual inner body awareness and interoception, is this notion that sensations are the substrate of emotions. In other words, they're the foundation. They support our emotions. If you have good interoception or good inner body awareness, which you can enhance, you have a better foundation to have a better relationship, a closer relationship with your emotions. So people who have a full sensate experience can have a full emotional experience. Christine Caldwell says, sensations become feelings, feelings become emotions. So there's a rising level of complexity there. So if you've got a good foundation, you can develop better complexity and a better granularity. And then what's coming through it academically is this link between what they call these peripheral ideas of emotion and linking that, exactly the opposite, linking people who don't have a good interoceptive awareness or don't have a good sensory sense of themselves internally to a number of cognitive and social and conceptual problems. A good example is social anxiety. So if you are not tapped into your body, you may be tapped into another level, emotions or constructs and language, and you're going to start struggling with that aspect of it. So you start living in the concepts and you're not living in your own sensations. So these two, sensations and attention, for me were crucial. And then I wondered what it would be like if you combine these two concepts. What if we very purposefully, very mindfully started focusing on our sensations? So we trained our attention and we specifically trained it on our sensations. And I started experimenting with this. And I did a thesis last year at Stellenbosch, took a handful of clients. Some of them were mine, some of them were other people's clients who'd done some body work in a corporate setting in a transformative coaching approach. So that's an approach that would involve the body, that would include the body as part of the process. And we did find a link between people who are able to tap into their sensory worlds and people who are able to change. So there are some technical terms around this, but in a simple sense, the technical terms are sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy. Three of maybe 12 terms in interoception. But really what I'm saying, simply, and I don't want to oversimplify it, but if you enhance your attention, and then you focus that attention on your sensations, some insight meditations would do that specifically, then you start to change without having to recalibrate your language and your constructs. And I've noticed this with clients. If you merely take them in to their bodies, they automatically start recalibrating their own constructs and their own language. So people ask me how, but how do you do that? And my short answer is body scan, body scan, body scan. I don't know how many of you know the body scan, but generally you can get a couple of audios off the web. You can get some apps with some great audios, and they generally will take you through your body in a very uniform way so that you start to enhance the areas of your body that you're not familiar with. For example, for me, I notice I've got lots of sensory information in my mouth. I don't have so much hair in my arms. It's quite a blank area. But over time, with body scan, I can improve that. And then I start to, you know, be able to live in my body and separate myself from my constructs. There's a fantastic notion that Christine Caldwell has written about based on, the idea that mindfulness is interpreted as being too conceptual. She calls it bodyfulness, and she's basically this invitation of us getting more sensory around our talking therapy conversations. So what I'm really asking you in a nutshell is what I call to go down and in. That if we hang around here too much in language, in the talking therapies, we are simply rearranging the deck chairs. It's like having a GPS. We've built this GPS. You know, when we were babies, we kind of live here, we quickly develop these capacities and then these capacities, and they get very sophisticated. And then we go to therapists to have this part rearranged. But we don't integrate it, and we don't embody it down into there. So I'm saying you can directly go, I'm wondering, if you can directly go straight in there and almost not have to do that. There's something that happens there, something universal, something non-linguistic. But it has to be grounded in a sensory space. And then, if you combine that with the talking therapies, which I think a number of therapies are now saying, somatic experiencing, I think focusing, Gendlin in 78 was saying this, very famous book called Focusing. He was saying, if you are working deeply enough with these three, and you're cross-training across them, and you're specifically, while you're talking about your challenge, noticing, you know, how that emotion sits in your sensory world and how it runs back into your language. So you're working with your sensations, your perception, and your language, and your emotion. But you're cross-training like that all the time in the actual session. You get very rapid transformation. So again, this is more a question for us as interveners. Where are you having the conversation? If you're asking your client about something that happened at work and he's calling it betrayal, are you recalibrating that relationship, and are you taking it into his sensory world as deeply as you possibly can, where you can actually give him the sensory training so that he can improve that grounding of that concept? So how do you know it's betrayal? Because you've seen it in a movie, because you read it in a book, or are we somehow grounding my individual experience of betrayal in my sensory system? So what I'm also thinking, and I think this is being supported, is that when you start hanging out here, you're tapping into something very, very personal and very, very granular and very specific, but it actually is also quite universal and quite unitary. So when you're grounded in your body, you may not be stuck in these constructs like an institutionalized religion comes to mind. So I would, you know, one of my things that I kind of tell people is, if the people in the Middle East were body scanning for the next two generations, they probably wouldn't be so conflicted about their constructs. Well, that's a contentious thing to say, I know. But This is why the idea of transformation, collective transformation, is relevant here, because it's deeply personal and therefore also collective. So what is our attentional style and tendency as interveners? Is it up there, external and divisive, or is it down here and unitary? So that's my talk, but I want to leave you with three quotes, because this also is coming out from different perspectives: biological, psychological, social, and spiritual. So Henry Nouwen, I'm sure a lot of you know, he's famous for saying the most personal is the most universal, the most hidden is the most public, and the most solitary is the most communal. What we live in the most intimate places of our beings is not just for us, but for all people. That is why our inner lives are lives for others. So that's a spiritual take on it. Damasio, who's pretty legendary at the moment as a neuroscientist, I think this is fantastic, because he's confirming a biological, spiritual connection here. In advanced meditation, you move away from extended consciousness, away from one's autobiography in relation to the world. It's what I'm calling the language, or the linguistics, the thinking, to concentrate on something deeper and simpler, one's core biological nature. So in a way, to get experience that I would qualify as spiritual or mystical, you're delving deeply toward the core of the being, rather than going up toward a more complicated aspect of self in its relation to society. So body instead of language and constructs. And lastly, I think Eckhart Tolle probably said it better, because this also sounds like a process. The key is to be in a state of permanent connectedness with your inner body, to feel it at all times. And this will rapidly deepen and transform your life. That's it.